Let us start, everyone. Again, we want to thank God for being here to speak with you this morning. Also thank the elders, deacons, pastor, church officers for allowing me to speak with you this morning and this week. And as we now conclude our Religious Liberty Week, we're going to be looking at Revelation 13. And we're going to read Revelation 14:9, because we see there a most solemn message given to the inhabitants of the earth in these last days. I want you to remember that the book of Revelation is written in symbols. And God's word has pronounced a blessing on the book. So I would ask you to, first of all, go with me and claim a promise in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 9 and 10. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 9 and 10. The Bible says, "But as it is written, I have not seen, nor ear heard, neither has entered the heart of man, the things that God has prepared for them that love him. But God hath revealed them unto us by his Spirit, for the Spirit searcheth all things, yea, the deep things of God." How many things does the Holy Spirit search, everybody? He searcheth all things, yea, the what? Deep things of God. And so this morning, we need to pray for the Holy Spirit to be with us and that he will guide us into all truth. We are living in the very time and signs of the last days. The word days in 2 Timothy 3:5, 1-5, the word days there is dealing with prophecy. And in prophecy, a day stands for a year. So you're not just living in the last days, you're living in the last years of Earth's history, according to the prophets and the apostles. And so with that thought in mind, let us have a word of prayer and ask God for the Holy Spirit to be with us. Father in heaven, we bow before thy throne, asking for the presence of thy Holy Spirit. We realize of our own selves we can do nothing. I realize of my own self I can do nothing. Ask that it be not me to speak now, but let thy word speak. Let Jesus be seen and Jesus be uplifted. Help us understand that our liberty is on a thread. Please, Father, open our eyes, we pray, and give us understanding of the Scriptures. Help us rightly divide the word of truth, we pray. We address our prayer to the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary, where Jesus is our great high priest. In Jesus' name and for his sake we do pray. Amen. I'd like you now to turn in your Bibles to Revelation 1:1. I want you to understand something, that if we open the book, there's two things we must understand. That Revelation is written in symbols and God has pronounced a blessing in the study of this book. In Revelation 1:1, the Bible says, "The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him, to show unto his servants things which must shortly come to pass. He sent and signified it by his angel unto his servant John, who bare record of the word of God, and of the testimony of Jesus Christ, and all things that he saw. Blessed is he that readeth, and they that hear the words of this prophecy, and keep those things which are written therein, for the time is at hand." Now the Bible pronounced a blessing on the book of Revelation, meaning that it's a blessing for us to read, hear, study, and maintain what is written in the book. Now go with me now to Revelation chapter 13. In Revelation chapter 13, remember, there's a blessing on the book, is that right? So therefore, we should understand the book. The The book is not written in mystery, it cannot be understood. The Bible says in Revelation chapter 13, looking here at verse 11, "And I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth, and it had two horns like a lion, and he spake as a dragon." Now, I want to ask the question, in the Bible, what do beasts represent? Let's take a look from the scriptures, and let's let the scriptures do the talking, amen? Because what I say may be true, but at the same time, it could be my opinion. I'm not here to give my opinion this morning. I'm here to give what the Word of God says. None of you are going home with me. You're only going home with the Bible. Amen? And if you got the Bible on your iPhone, on your iPad, or your cell phone, you can look it up there as well. But let's see what the Bible says about the symbols in the book of Revelation chapter 13. The Bible says, now what is a beast? In Daniel chapter 7, turn me to Daniel chapter 7, and let's look here at verse 23. Daniel chapter 7, verse 23. Are you with me now? In Daniel 7, 23, the Bible says this. Are you there? Thus he said. Now remember, in Daniel chapter 7, there were four beasts. There was a lion with two wings, a bear with three ribs in his mouth, and there was a four-headed leopard. And now the angel, and it was this non-descriptive beast, and now the angel is about to tell Daniel what these beasts mean. Look what the Bible says here, Daniel 7:23. Thus he said, the fourth beast shall be the fourth kingdom upon the earth. Now wait a minute. What did the Bible say a beast represented? A beast in the Bible represented a kingdom. Now, I know people try to call this the beast and that over there the beast, a computer a beast. That's not what the Bible said. The Bible said the beast is a kingdom. And the Bible goes on and says in Daniel 7:23, does it that the fourth kingdom shall be the what? It says here, the fourth beast shall be the fourth kingdom upon the earth, which shall bear diverse from all kingdoms and shall devour the whole earth and tread it down and break it in pieces. So the Bible shows a beast is a what? Kingdom. Let's go back to Revelation chapter 13, verse 11. I beheld another beast coming up out of the what? Earth. Now this beast here came up out of the earth. If we compare this with Revelation 13, 1, we've got about another beast, a first beast. Go to Revelation chapter 13, verse 1. Revelation chapter 13, looking here at verse 1. The Bible says, and I stood upon the sands of the sea, and I saw a beast rise about the sea, having seven heads and ten horns, and it says, and ten crowns. It says, yes, ten heads, ten horns, and it says, ten crowns, and upon his head, the name, what? Blessing. Now, but where did this beast come from? Now, we're reading in Revelation 13, 1. This beast came up out of the what? Sea. But in Revelation 13, 11, this beast comes up out of the what? Earth. Now we're going to look a little closer. What is the identification of this beast? Does the Bible tell us, or is it just a mystery? Maybe we don't know what the beast is. Maybe it is a computer mark. Maybe it's a microchip. Maybe it's something else. Maybe it's a name of a person. Or perhaps, let's see. The first of all, the scripture said that the beast was a kingdom. A kingdom is a nation in Bible prophecy. Are you with me now? Babylon was a nation. Medo-Persia was a nation. Grecia was a nation. Rome, pagan Rome, was a nation. And so we're going to find here something interesting. I beheld another beast coming out of the earth. What is the earth talking about? And now, this beast came up out of the earth. Now, first of all, a beast is a nation. So our nation came up out of the what? Earth. But now, where did this nation come from that's going to come up out of this earth? Go with me to Revelation chapter 12, verse 16. Let's look here at verse 14 through 16. And the Bible said, and to the woman were given two wings of a great eagle, that she might fly into the wilderness, into her place, where she is nourished for a time, and a half a time from the face of the serpent. A time in the Bible is 360. Times 2 is 720. A half a time is 180. For 1,260 years, a woman fled and was in the wilderness. represented in prophecy. Go with me to Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 2. Jeremiah 6, verse 2. Let's see what the Bible has to say. Jeremiah 6, 2, the Bible says, I am likened the daughter of Zion unto a comely and delicate, what everybody? Woman. So, wait a minute. A woman represents the daughter of Zion. Well, who is the daughter of Zion? Go with me in your Bibles to Isaiah 51, 16. Isaiah chapter 51, verse 16. Let's see if the Bible tells us who the daughter of Zion is. In Isaiah 51, 16, the Bible says, I have put my words in thy mouth, and I have covered thee with the shadow of my hand, that I may plant the heavens, and lay the foundation of the earth, and say unto Zion, thou art my people. The daughter of Zion represents God's, who everybody? People. God's people is talking about Christianity. And later it's talking about Protestant Christianity. So we find that God's people are represented as the daughter of Zion or his church. Are you with me now? Are you with me? I just wonder if you see. So now let's wait a minute now. And now the Bible says, and the dragon, this up here, and the serpent did what? And the serpent cast out of his mouth water as a flood after the woman. Water after a flood after a woman. What does water represent in Scripture? Let's take a look for a moment. Let's see something. The Bible foretells something that will take place. Look carefully for a moment. In Revelation chapter 17, and listen to verse 15 for a moment. Revelation 17, 15. The Bible says in Revelation chapter 17, verse 15, the Bible says, and thus he said unto me, the waters which thou sawest, where the horse sitteth, are what? People, multitudes, nations, and tongues. In prophecy, water or sea represents people, multitudes, nations, and tongues. But now, the Bible says that the serpent cast out of his mouth water as a flood. When Revelation uses the term serpent, it's talking about the character of the power that's about to attack or go after God's church. But this term serpent indicates this power is using deception. In Genesis chapter 3, we read the first time the word serpent is used, and we can see the characteristic. The Bible said in Genesis chapter 3, verse 1, it said, now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, yea, have God said, you may eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, and we may eat of every tree of the garden, but the fruit is of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, we shall not eat of it. Neither shall you touch it, lest you die. Now, the serpent used deception because he said, you shall not truly die, for in the day you eat thereof, your eyes shall be opened, and you shall be as gods, knowing what? Good and evil. Did Adam and Eve become gods when they ate of the tree? Did they know good and evil, though? Yes, they did. But they didn't become gods. And then, the Bible said in Genesis chapter 5, and Adam lived 930 years old, and he died. So Adam and Eve were deceived, and the serpent is a symbol of deception. Deception among the multitudes, and nations, and kindred, and people of earth. And the Bible said the dragon cast out his water as a serpent after the woman. The serpent cast out his water as a flood after the woman. But now who's the woman? The church. And the Bible says something, and the what? Revelation 12, 16, the Bible says what? 12, 15, and 16. Look what it says. The Bible says here, and the earth helped the woman. Who helped the woman? The earth. What did you mean, the earth helped the woman? What is earth a symbol of? Go with me to Genesis chapter 1. Genesis chapter 1, and let's look here for a moment, at verses 10 and 11. And the Bible says, and God called the dry land earth, and the gathering together waters called he seas. What was the dry land called? Earth. Now let's reverse it. The earth was called what? Dry land. A land helped the woman. A land helped the church. What land helped a persecuted church? In the old world of nations, multitudes, and tongues,
and then would come to a new world to set the foundation for religious liberty. Only one nation fits the specification of this prophecy. We're going to see more in a little bit. And that is the United States of America. The woman, God's church, Christianity, Protestantism. In the old world, they could not have religious liberty. Because of papal supremacy for 1260 years. Now, a lot of people don't want to go there because we want to be politically correct on some things. But let me just be real with you from the Bible. God's word foretold the time when this nation would rise. God's word is going to be clear on the matter. History bears witness that America came into existence because of religious liberty, because of persecution, and the right then that freedom of conscience was not given them. In the old world, when Pedro ruled in Europe, we found you had a sacral society. A sacral society is a society where everybody worships at the same shrine. And that went on for centuries. And the Bible was a forbidden book. But as time would go on, God foretold a time when we would have a Protestant Reformation. And the Protestant Reformation brought about the Bible being translated into the languages of the common people. When the common people were finally able to read the Bible for themselves, it began to free their minds from papal dogma and superstition. Now, I know that many people don't like to go back to history. But in Ecclesiastes 1:9, your Bible says that you and I have to study history. Go back with me for just a moment. Let's see what God requires from His Word. Like I said, you're not going home with me. You're going home with your Bible. So this is in your Bible. Amen? Look here. Ecclesiastes 1:9. Look what the Bible says. We want to know what the future holds for this nation. You want to know what the future holds for the rest of the world? Get ready, because God has already told you how you can find out. Ecclesiastes 1:9 says, the thing that has been is that which shall be. And that which is done is that which shall be done. And there is no new thing under the sun. So wait a minute. That which has been is the past. That which shall be is the future. God foretells that the history of the past will be repeated. The characteristics of history will be brought forth in the last days of remnant time. And you will see this again, God is saying. And if you want to know, then you better go back and study history. Look at Ecclesiastes 3:15 with me for a moment. The Bible says in Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 15, those are the word of God says again. Then it says here, Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 15, that which hath been is now, and that which is to be hath already been. God requires that which is past. What does God require? You go back, use your intelligent reasoning, and look at the facts. Isaiah 1:18-19 says, come now, let us reason together. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be whiter than snow. And though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. But notice what God says, come now, let us, what everybody, reason together. Why? You need to reason about the future by reasoning and going back and looking at your facts. People who won't study their past are doomed to repeat it. We need to understand what we are. Going back to Revelation 13 now. We find a land helped the woman. People that were being persecuted in a country that they wanted religious freedom because of sacral society. The Protestant Reformation came along and it brought about a composite society in the old world of Europe. A composite society, you had Catholics over here and you had Lutherans over here. And you had some other people that were coming up on the scene, and they were known as Anabaptists. And all of a sudden, the Anabaptists were being persecuted by Luther and Melanchthon because the Anabaptists believed in baptism by immersion, which comes from the origin of how we get the Baptist church, where I originally came from. Are you with me now? And therefore, and where we practice today, baptism by immersion, are you with me now? And Luther and Melanchthon had still followed the tradition of sprinkling, and the Anabaptists disagreed with it, and they had the Anabaptists persecuted, and they even had your baptism, we're gonna baptize you. This was under Luther and Melanchthon. Not only have the papal power persecuted people, but even Protestants who misunderstand certain things at times, or who become extreme in certain areas, can actually become persecutors themselves. So, people who were looking for a new world, people heard about a new world in a far off land, and they took a ship called the Mayflower, and they crossed that Atlantic, and it landed on a place called Plymouth Rock. And when they got up Plymouth Rock, those Puritans came on Plymouth Rock. Now, don't forget, don't get me wrong, some of the Puritans had some areas that was kind of strange too. But at the same time, they were all seeking for religious freedom. And they came on Plymouth Rock, and they got on their knees and prayed, and they said, finally, we have a country without a king, and a religion without a pope.
Amen.
That's what happened. Then Roger Williams comes along. He begins to find that in certain colonies, he cannot have religious freedom. So he begins to set up his own colony. Then we have what is known as Philadelphia. Just give you a little sketch. I can't go into much detail right now. So now we're going to find that this lamb-like beast. Why did the Bible call him a lamb-like beast? What is it about this beast or this kingdom or this nation that's about to rise, that comes up out of the earth, a scarcely populated area? What is it about him right quick? Let's see for a moment. It says, I beheld no beast coming out of the earth, Revelation 13:11. Go back with me for a moment. I beheld no beast coming out of the earth. He had two horns like a what? Lamb, and he spake as a dragon. Two horns like a lamb? But let's talk about lamb for a moment. What does lamb represent? Go with me to John 1:29. John chapter 1, verse 29. In John 1:29, the Bible says, the next day John seeth Jesus coming, and said, behold the Lamb of God, which take away the sin of the world. Now John called Jesus a lamb. Now look at John 1:36. In John chapter 1, verse 36, the Bible says again, and looking upon Jesus as he walked, he said, behold the Lamb of God. Now wait a minute. When in both cases, John calls Jesus a what? A lamb. Now look for a moment at 1 Peter 1:18-19. 1 Peter 1:18-19. The Bible said, for what you know you will not redeem with corruptible things of silver and gold from your vain conversations received by tradition of your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ as of a lamb without blemish and without spot. So a lamb was a symbol of Jesus. Now are we saying that, now we take these symbols and we go over to Revelation 13:11, are we saying that this lamb-like beast is Jesus? The answer is no. But the lamb-like beast will have in its rise, the nation that comes up will have in its rise, it will have the principles of Jesus in its rise, the power in the earth. What were the principles of Jesus? Let's see, because remember Revelation speaking of what? Symbols. So the lamb is symbolic of the principles that will be in the king of this beast or of the nation that's going to rise. So what are the principles of Jesus that's going to be seen in this nation or in this so-called beast? Let's take a look at one for a moment. Let's go to John 8:32. John chapter 8, verse 32. In John 8:32, most of you know this when you quote it all the time. In John 8:32, the Bible says, and ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Now before you go there, the first thing that nation has, it holds on in the beginning to truth. And what is truth? Pilate asked Jesus the question. He said, what is truth? John 14:6, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Jesus is truth. What is truth? John 17:17, he said, sanctify them to thy truth. Thy word is truth. So the word of God is truth. What is truth? John 16:13 says, albeit when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth. The Holy Ghost is truth. And then the Bible says in Psalms 119:151, thou art me, O Lord, and all thy commandments are truth. Okay. Now, wait a minute. Let's connect that now in John 8:32. 32. And ye shall know the truth. The word know is the Greek word gnosko. Ye shall know what? Ye shall know Jesus, his word, the Holy Ghost. You will have experience with the Holy Ghost. Jesus, his word, and the commandments of God, and understanding this and experiencing this will make you free.
Amen.
Free from what? Look what the Bible says in Romans 6, 16 through 18. Let's see what God's truth is to make you free from. First and foremost. And God, in Romans 6, 16 through 18, the Bible said it this way. It says, know ye not to whom you yield yourselves service to obey? His servants who are whom you obey, whether sin unto death or obedience unto righteousness. But God be thanked that ye were servants of sin, but have obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which was delivered unto you. Being then made free from sin, ye became servants of righteousness. What were you made free from?
Sin.
Free from sin. What is sin? 1 John 3, 4 says, whosoever committeth sin transgresseth the law, for sin is the transgression of the law. So the Bible says God has given you redemption to restore you unto his, to forgive your sins, restore you in this image, and turn around and give you power to obey his commandments and not break his commandments. We live in a size, we live in a time. People believe anything goes. Live in a time of immorality such as we have never seen, unprecedented in the day in the history of this world, especially in this nation. Where are we standing now? Our children don't know who they are anymore. Crime and violence is reaching an all-time high. The immorality seems to prevail everywhere. What time are you living in? Paul told you in 1 Timothy chapter 3, 2 Timothy 3, 1-5, this know also, that in the last days, perilous times will come. Huh? Show me there for a minute. 2 Timothy 3, 1-5. I want to show you the time. You can just tell me if it's there or not. You don't have to believe me. You got the Bible in your hand. You go back and study it when you get time. Look what the Bible says. 2 Timothy chapter 3, 1-5. Are you there? Look what the Bible says. Won't you see it with me? The Bible says, this know also, that in the last days, or in the last years, prior to Christ's return, it says perilous or dangerous times shall come. Men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, truth-breakers, ungodly, unthankful. This is boasters, proud, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affections, truth-breakers, false accusers, incontinent, meaning they will lose self-control. They won't know how to control themselves. They can't control their temper. They can't control their sex drive. They have issues. They have problems in the last days. Young people will be disobedient to parents, have no respect whatsoever, don't care how much the mother and father sacrifice, and turn around and look at you and say, I deserve it. That's when you feel like you want to just almost grab them and put them out. And then you got these new laws that say you can't touch your children. Y'all remember when our parents used to touch us? We could sing the song, he touched me. Oh yeah. And oh, I'm made whole. You know, when your mama looked at you and you were getting ready to get disciplined, something happened. Something happened. And you're going that room. Y'all remember that? We forgot about them days, you know. But anyway, it says here, without natural affections, incontinent, fierce, despise of those that are good, traitors, petty, high-minded, lovers of pleasure, born in lovers of God, having a form of godliness, but denying the power, suffering such turn away. It says here, watch very carefully, form of godliness, meaning they deny the work of the Holy Spirit in their life for the transformation of character. And the Bible says this will be a sign of the last days. 19 prevailing sins, and we're looking right at them right now. All over America, all over the world. Jesus said, as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be in the day of the Son of Man. They were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, until the day that Noah entered the ark, and the flood came and destroyed them all. Even thus shall it be in the day of the coming of the Son of Man. And then he told you, as it was in the days of Lot, they did eat, they drink, they bought, they sold, they planted, they killed. But the same day that Lot went out of Sodom, it rained fire and brimstone from heaven and destroyed them all. Right. Now we got Noah's day, 2015, we got Lot. Now we're sitting here 3 years later and our children saying they're Jews. And we think some of those things are wonderful things. Wonderful thing to follow humanistic teachings. Wonderful thing to follow socialist principles. be in America forgot what we are as a nation.
Yep.
Beloved, Rome forgot. Rome failed. She started promoting homosexuality and other things. When she did, everybody was trying to be politically correct at the time. When she did, finally they had a despot on the throne named Caligula. You remember him? Caligula had to be killed. One of his own men had to kill him because he was so despotic, so vile. And the people were glad to finally get rid of him. We live in such a time. Let me tell you something. God loves everybody, but he hates sin. Jesus came to deliver you from sin that you might stay in God's love. He did not come to save you in your sin, nor condone you and encourage you to remain in it. The plan of salvation says in Matthew 1:21, "For thou shalt, and she shall bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins." Now let's go back. So the principles of the Lamb is what? He shall know the truth. This truth is going to be part of the principles, which represents, and in truth we have the law of God. Is the law, was the law of God found in America? Go to the Supreme Court buildings, look on the doors of the Supreme Court. What did you see? You have the Ten Commandments at one time hanging in the courtroom. Over, even just over the judge's desk and even on the oak doors that they had in those days. In other words, this country knew what God, what meant, what it means to have God. They understood what persecution was. That's why when they made the conscience and Congress had made no law respecting the establishment of religion and the free exercise thereof. The Constitution provided for a separation of church and state. Didn't tell you to unite church and state. Let's see what the principles of Jesus was. Go with me, Bible moment. Go with me. Let's go back to the principles of Jesus. Let's see. Did America have truth? Yes. Did America have the Ten Commandments? Yes. Did America advocate the Bible at one time? Yes. Did America, and did the churches of America, did they believe in the Holy Spirit? Yes. Did they believe the scriptures were true? Yes. Let's go a bit closer. History bears these things out. You can go back and look it up. You can go back and look at our American history and find it right there. Now let's go back a little closer. The Bible says, "You shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you what? Free." Let's talk about something. Let's talk about freedom for a moment. Freedom. Yeah, go to 2 Timothy. Go to 2 Corinthians 3:16. I think it said 1 Corinthians. I think 1 Corinthians. Let me make sure I can be right. I don't want to give you the wrong text here for a moment. Look here. 3:17. 3:17 is what I want. But it's going to be 2 Corinthians 3:17. I believe it. 2 Corinthians 3:17. Is that the one? Let's see. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 17. Yes. Now the Lord is that what? Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is what?
Liberty.
There is liberty. Wait a minute. Where does liberty originate? With God. Through the Holy Spirit. Making you free from what?
Sin.
And giving you power to obey God. And keep his laws and keep his covenants. And in doing that, many of us in this nation right now, the only reason why we don't sit in prison is because we keep the laws of the land. And as long as we stay in harmony with these laws, we are called freedom. We have freedom in this nation. If our children or one of us should break the law and violate the law by robbing a bank or doing something strange on the streets that are contrary to the law, we are arrested. Demonstrating that freedom is based on obedience to God's law.
Amen.
The moral law, first and foremost. Because our constitutional freedoms happen to have some of the same issues that the actual document is also based on the foundation of God's law and the Magna Carta. Okay? Now let's go a little closer. So we find that freedom will be one of the major teachings or major issues of this nation that's coming to power. This nation will not only give freedom, but it will give liberty. And at the same time, the Bible foretells that this beast had two horns like a lamb. What do horns represent in the Bible? Go with me to Habakkuk chapter 3. What do you see with me? Are you there? Turn with me. What do you see? Habakkuk chapter 3, The Bible tells us again. Are you there? Now the Bible says here in Habakkuk chapter 3, the Bible says here, look here at verse 4 with me. And his brightness was as a light. He had horns come out of his hands, and there was a what? Hiding of his what? Power. Horns in the Bible is a symbol of power. What type of power? Now, how many horns did he have? Two. Two horns. It had power. You have religion and you have political power. In this nation that's rising, we're going to find that in this nation it had a political power, a religious power. The political power was a republic. The religious power was protestant. And under these two principles, they formed a nation that gave religious freedom. Understanding what had took place in the old world and laid a foundation in a new world where they would not have to have worry about their religion and what they believe. Today we live in a time. These things are becoming very important for us to know and understand and remember our past. So the beast that's coming up out of the earth has a characteristic, first of all, of Christ. It carries with it truth, the word of God, his law. It starts off this way. It starts off with the idea of without a day of freedom or liberty. But then the Bible says something else about this beast. The Bible says something else about him. He had two horns. That's a religious aspect and a political aspect, or a Protestant and Republican form of government. Well, let's go one more step. What did Jesus say about the issue of power and horns? What did Jesus say about these things? Because we're going to find out that this beast's secret of our survival is in what the principles of Jesus have said. Go me to Mark chapter 12. Mark chapter 12. In Mark chapter 12, we read something very important about a principle of Jesus. Mark chapter 12, looking here at verse 14. And when they were come, they said unto him, Master, we know that thou art true and carest for no man, for thou regardest not the person of men, but teachest the way of God in truth. Is it lawful? Is it lawful to give tribute to Caesar or not? Now Caesar represented the government. And the Jews were trying to catch Jesus. This is called the entrapment. And it says here, shall we give or shall we not give? But he, knowing their hypocrisy, said unto them, why tempt ye me? Bring me a penny that I may see it. And they brought it, and he said unto them, whose is this image and superscription? And they answered unto him, Caesar's. And Jesus answering said unto them, render unto Caesar the things that are Caesar, and to God the things that are God's. And they marveled at him. What did Jesus do? Jesus said, give Caesar, give the government what he is. Don't try to keep the government. Don't try to get around it. Whatever they require, give it to them. And then give God what is God's. Jesus drove separation of church and state. Though the church can have an influence on society, the church were not to govern the political aspect of the nation. Why? Because in the old world, the first beast, which represented the papal supremacy, they used church and state. And whatever the church wanted, the state did. But America would be different. The secret of her strength, the success of her power, was the separation of church and state. And no matter how serious you come up with religion, no matter how much you talk about the goodness of God, God has not, in his word, established or endorsed the religions of our nation, the denominations of our nation, saying that we should unite the church. Uniting the church with the state will bring evil results. Amen. Because it will not be for the minority. You see, separation of church and state was for not for the majority religion, it was for the minorities who had a right to believe and worship according to their own conscience.
Amen.
Even if you didn't agree with me, I have the right. Now, I don't have the right to cause anarchy. I don't have the right to sit there and cause riots. I don't have the right to sit there and call them getting fanatic or go shoot somebody. But I do have the right to express my viewpoint. We are foretold that this lamb like beast will speak like a dragon. A dragon in the Bible was a dragon. Go read Revelation chapter 12, verse 7 through 9. Let's read about the dragon for just a moment. As we get down to the major points before we close. The Bible says here, I don't look very carefully, the Bible says here, and there was war in heaven, and Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought with his angels, and prevailed not, neither was that place found anymore in heaven. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. Now the Bible says a war took place in heaven. It was a cosmic war, a battle, a great controversy, if you please, and between Christ and Satan. We know that the Bible says the devil and his angels are very real. In high places, there are people who worship the devil and his angels. But let's go a little closer. You still don't believe me. In Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12, the Bible says, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood. We wrestle not against what? But it means we're not dealing with human beings. Now, whether you want to believe that or not, you're not dealing with one another. No matter how much you hate each other. No matter how much you dislike this man or that woman. You're not just dealing with that. Even our president of this nation is not just dealing with flesh and blood. Bible says, you got spiritual wickedness in high places that are trying to control them and manipulate human beings. We are not alone. We have some ETs, and the Bible has identified them. They're not unidentified. They're identified. They're the devil and his angels. 1 Peter 5, it says, be sober, be diligent, for your adversary, the devil, is as a roaring lion walking about, seeking whom he may devour. We don't see them. Invisible forces of darkness are real. If you don't believe it, then think about the time you lay in your bed, you could not move. You felt like something was pressing you down. You sat there in the bed, going back and forth. You couldn't say nothing. And there's something in your mind that says, say Jesus. And I said, you say Jesus, and it breaks. You said, oh, you had a problem. We know that that's called demonic attack. You don't believe that because all that is a muscle spasm. Okay, you can play it off if you want to. You go to the doctor and say, doctor, well, if it's a muscle spasm, then why is it when I say Jesus, it breaks? Nothing else will heal. You don't have to believe me. I'm just telling you what goes on. We don't like to talk about those things. When those things happen, we don't tell our friends or our family because we don't want anybody to think we're weird. There's something strange going on, but it happened. Some of us can recall it too. Some of us got so scared, we cut the light on. It happened with the light on one night. Now, get out of yourself down here. It ain't no other than me. He's a beautiful fallen angel who can transform themselves even into human form. Well, no marvel, 2 Corinthians 11:14, remember? No marvel, Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. If it ain't great thing, is that his ministers be transformed into ministers of righteousness, whose end is according to their works. So we're going to find that this beast coming up out of the earth to speak like what? Dragon, meaning America will change. What's going to change in this nation? Eventually we will change our constitution. It's almost becoming a piece of paper. Almost. Recently, we had something unconstitutional happen. But most people don't want to hear it. Because some Christians like what they like what's going on. Let me tell you something. It doesn't matter who's in office. The issue is, are they going to stand by the principles that make the nation what it is? God is no respecter of persons. In the book of Daniel, chapter 2, the Bible tells us how men rise. Look what it says. I'm saying this to make it very plain from the Word of God. Look what it says. Daniel chapter 2. Look at verse 19 and 20. Daniel 2, 19 and 20. The Bible says, are you there? Daniel 2, 19 and 20. The Bible says here, Daniel answered and said, blessed be the name of God forever and ever. Wisdom and might are what? His. He changeth times and seasons. He removeth kings and set up kings. He giveth wisdom unto the wise and knowledge to them that know understanding. He revealeth the deep and secret things. He knoweth what is in the darkness, that love for light dwelleth in him. God set up kings, he removed kings. Nobody is anywhere except by the power of God. Now what they do, what they choose as free moral agents, they have a right to. If they fear God, if you fear God, you're going to do the right thing. This nation is supposed to have a separation of church and state. But because of religious zeal today, and I'm going to tell you why. Because with the last administration, we went on the far left. Now all of a sudden, we got an administration going to the far right. And the far right is going too far right. They won't stay in the middle. The far left went too far left. And now we got a situation where the pendulum swung this way, and now the pendulum's swinging back this way. And we go this way, and we got religious zealots that want to make this nation great, but they believe they're going to make it great by bringing in religious laws. It's coming. Just as good as my name is Maurice Barrett, just as good as you sit here today, it's coming. But will it be religious liberty? No! It will appear to be in the beginning. But suppose you pass a law. I was talking with a Muslim one day. And this Muslim guy said to me, no, not my Muslim, he was a Hebrew. He was I call him a Farrakhan guy. He was from Farrakhan. And you know, brother with the bean pies and stuff. Good brothers. And the brother came to me and said to me, he said, my brother, he said, now, you know, we should all go back to Africa. And stuff like that. He was talking like that to me. And I said, really? He said, yeah, because we can have our own type of democracy, and we can do some things, and black people get ahead. And it sounded really good for a moment. Then I asked him a question. I said, well, suppose when I get there, I decide I want to disagree with Farrakhan. I said, will you really give me religious freedom? Will you give me freedom of conscience? Or when you say that brother's getting dangerous, we need to get rid of him like y'all got rid of Malcolm.
Come on.
I said, y'all don't know it, right? He said, my brother, what? I said, brother, listen to you real too. Come on. You in the United States of America, you can push your propaganda about black folk and black community. You can do all of that. You can talk about how we need to go back to Africa. You can do that in this country because you are allowed, you are given the right to religious freedom of expression. I said, but when that freedom is not given to you, no matter how much you say, if you take that from me, then you are going to suppress my religious freedom, and eventually you're going to have me arrested, persecuted, and maybe even killed if you think I'm too dangerous for your nation. Yeah. Then he got quiet. He said, wait, where you from? Where you from? I'm a 7-11 child. Yeah, y'all. Talking like that to me. But he was wearing out my brothers in the church, because I had some friends of a Baptist, and they were wearing them out with their rhetoric. And the Baptist brother couldn't answer because he didn't know his Bible well enough when he was trying. And I sat there trying to keep quiet the whole time while I was getting my hair cut. But when the brother got too quiet, and he thought he was beating my little Baptist brother to death, I said, hold on. I said, hold on, brother, sit down. What are you talking about? You know, sometimes righteous indignation rises up in you when you see people being oppressed, and you know they got the thing, you know they stand for right. They just don't have the answers that you want, but you know that you got the answer. And sometimes you gotta just interfere. Like when I ran across the black Hebrew Israelite brothers. You remember them, don't you? Y'all know them. Wearing little fringes on their garments. Yo, my brother, you know that the law was given for Israel. Then the brother said, only people going to heaven is black people and some Spanish. And I said, hold on, brother. Didn't the Bible say God made all nations one blood? All nations mean people, nations, tongues, and kindreds. All one blood. And he had a brother, read this for me. I said, no, John, don't read that. Just shut up for a minute and listen. See, you know, sometimes they use intimidation tactics because they don't think you know your Bible. And I sat there and I said to him, I said, the law was not given for Israel. The law was given to all mankind. I said, what do you now? He said, it was for Israel. I said, Romans chapter 5 says, Paul said, now we know in Romans chapter 5, look at Romans chapter 5. Jimmy, I'm going to show you. Right here. I just want to give you an idea. I want you to see something from it. Get down to our clothes. Look here. Romans chapter 5. I took you to this right here so you can see something. But, all right? The Bible says here, for when we were, okay, and look at verse 13. For until the law, sin was in the world. Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses. And I stop right there for a moment. The Bible said until the law. Now until the law was spoken, it says here, now the law was given at Sinai. But wait a minute. The Bible said that death reigned from Adam to Moses. But wait a minute. Adam was the first man. If death reigned, what does that tell us? Romans 6:23 says in the next chapter, the wage of sin is what? Death. So wait a minute. If death reigned from Adam to Moses, that means the law was in effect. How do you know? Because the law says the wages of sin is
death,
and sin is a transgression of the law. Therefore, death reigned because sin was in the world, and sin indicated the law was in the world and being transgressed. And so the law was given to all mankind, human beings and spirit beings. For in 1 John 3:8, the Bible said, he that committed sin is of the devil. For the devil sinned from the beginning. For this purpose was the Son of God manifest, that he might destroy the works of the devil. And in 1 John 3:4, the Bible says here in 1 John 4, where it talks about there, it says there, he was a liar and murderer from the beginning, brought not truth. When he speaks of a lie, he speaks of his own, for he's a liar and the father of it. 1 John 3:8. That's right, Jesus said the devil's a liar and the father what? And therefore, if he's a liar, that means that he, the Lucifer, in heaven, had understanding of the law. God can't call you a liar, because where there is no law, there is no sin. So I just want to make it clear. So when I'm talking to black Hebrews like God, suddenly he got mad, and now, you know how to do a big crowd. And then all of a sudden he said, well, wait a minute, you know, my brother, we need to go. So I said, no, we don't need to go. So just hold on right there. Now you've started this, now let's finish it. But you got all these people in here, mesmerized out here, talking about only the black people going to heaven. I said, Jesus didn't die for black people, he died for all people. Amen. So how you going to sit there and talk like that? And the law of God said, I'm not going to write the law on stone anymore. When did God say he's going to write the law? For black people, white people, Jews, or did not anybody who accept Christ. Where did God say he would write the law? I said, in Hebrews chapter 8, verse 10, the Bible said it this way. And this is the covenant now with the house of Israel after those days, said the Lord. I'll put my laws in their minds and write them in their hearts. And I'll be them a God, this union of people. And they shall not teach every man his neighbor, and every man his brother, saying, no, Lord. For all shall know me from these to the greatest. And I'll be merciful to their unrighteousness, and their sins and iniquities will I remember no more. God wrote his law in your heart when you were born again.
Amen.
Black, white, Jew, Hispanic, or whatever. And with that, there was no more said. That's the first time I saw them actually be quiet. And I don't say it before the glory of God, I give glory to God. Because the Bible says, sit on your heart not to meditate what you'll answer. Father, give you a mouth of wisdom if your enemies cannot hear you, so you know what he says. We are just sharing for God Christ. But in closing now, the Bible foretells that America will speak like a dragon. Our nation is changing. The election came up, said, I want to make America great again. America was great with separation of church and state. America was great without the papacy. We don't want to go there because it's stated that this power, according to the Bible, is represented by the first beast, the great Antichrist of the prophets, is there.
Yes.
But the Bible foretells that America, a man like this, and the first beast will come together. And as America comes together, as Protestants, Catholics, world religions begin to come together, and as they begin to continue with continence with one another, Protestants of the United States will yield up Protestantism. October 31st, 2017. Some, not all, but a great majority said the protest was over. We're no longer Protestant. So if we're no longer Protestant, I want to show you listen to them from a spiritual standpoint. I want to show you from a physical standpoint. I want to show you what's affecting us from a social standpoint now. If we're no longer Protestant, and when the protest is over, then we don't have to be, we can give up Protestantism, and we all can become Roman Catholic. Or the nation can become Catholic. Now, I don't have nothing personally against the the idea of Catholics, because I got family as Catholic. But I do have a problem with the principles of the papal system. Because I know from history that this system is a system of church and state. When the Bible says this man might be from an image to the first beast, it is talking about the union of church and state. Now, I wouldn't worry about it, and I wouldn't say anything about it if it hadn't happened. We've been watching something for the last few years. And from 2006, when George Bush passed the faith-based initiative program, he decided to make the churches that receive federal funding agencies of the state. Quiet as it was, that's what it was. Especially those who were getting tax-deductible receipts. Then later, Barack Obama continued the faith-based initiative program for a while. But now Donald Trump has went one step further. Now each case, by right, the separation of church and state requires that the Congress does not have to fund parochial schools or private schools. But now we've come to the point, through these initiatives and through receiving federal aid, that now we're going to have faith-based initiative programs. And now we've got to the point where President Trump established a religious office in the White House. Unprecedented in the history of this nation.
Wow.
Now we all know, you're bringing about a union of church and state. Now it may not look like that. You say, well, brother, it's just an office and we're just going to deal with some things. But this office, according to the newspaper, will also be influential in making, be influential in policy making. In closing point, when Rome fell, Justinian in the East could not control the empire. The nation was divided. And Justinian saw that he was losing power and influence among the people. So he called on a man that he saw had influence over the people. His name was Severus. Severus was the bishop of Rome. And he was a man that loved God. He refused to get involved with politics and everything else. And so when Rome broke out with a war with the Goths, Severus refused to enter that war or join sides. So the Goths wrote him a letter saying that he should open the city of Rome to help, let them help defeat the Romans. And he refused. Then General Belisarius decided to write him a letter to open the doors, and he refused for them too. Severus did not want to have anything to do with the war between the Romans and the Goths. The Goths were defeating the Romans at every point. They ran the Romans all the way up to the very walls of the city. And when General Belisarius saw that his armies were at the walls of the city, he sent a message to Justinian and asked Justinian to send a message or please ask Severus to open the doors, open the gates, open the walls of the city. And Justinian had a wife. She was a Christian. And she turned around and went to her husband, Justinian, and begged him to open the gates of General Belisarius at the War of the Goths. Severus did. When Severus did, General Belisarius and his armies mustered up their strength one more time, and they defeated the Goths. This is the beginning of establishment of the Western Empire under the rule of Rome, of papal Rome. When General Belisarius got in the walls, and Justinian and him had a secret meeting, they had decided they would get rid of Severus because he did not open the gates, and he had refused in the beginning. And they decided to get rid of him because they said, this religious man has too much power, and he's having more influence over the people than we are. Then suddenly, they said, we're going to put in our own bishop. So they deposed Severus, and they put in Vigellius. And Vigellius was supposed to be just a docile puppet office of religion. Talk about history now. And it would just be a little office of religion, just as Justinian was supposed to control, because he felt that he couldn't control the people politically. So he used the office of religion, and he was going to use that to help control the situation in Rome. As time went on, this little docile religious office of this bishop called Vergilius became more powerful. As time went on, he got to the point that people want to hear him more than they want to hear Justin. And as time went on, the bishop, this little office of religion, was forced to take on political issues. When he took on political issues, later he finally moved, Justinian was finally moved out of the way, and Vergilius became the head of politics as well as religion. And this began the rule of the first popes. This is right here in Wikipedia. You can find all this stuff, it's all there. Not hiding anything. Now, wait a minute, God said, remember what? Past. So now, we in America, who's had separation of church and state for so long, I'm now saying that religion is a vital part, as President Trump put it. Faith is more powerful than government, and God is more powerful than all. I'm just rephrasing terms. Now, hold on. What you got now is you're going to have a little docile religious office of religion in the White House that appears just to be just as something that's going to help out with the communities in the beginning. But as time goes on, the evil results will come because the religious aspect that will now be part of this White House is going to start to dictate to Congressmen, to others. Congressmen, I'm saying you love. Take time, go back and study that history. You know most of the history already. But at the same time, I know you also deal with things that you cannot talk about. One thing I can tell you, please, by God's grace of God, go to God on your knees, ask God for wisdom, and ask God to give you strength. When it's time to make a stand, you can stand for what is right. The Holy God will give you strength. Your friends may turn against you. Fellow politicians may turn around and say, hey man, you on the wrong side on this one. But by the grace of God, with your Bible in your hand, and with an understanding of fearing God, make sure you stand for right. Make that alone. You may become a fanatic. You could almost lose everything you have, but in the eyes of God, you won't lose anything. Okay, you'll keep your integrity and keep your dignity by the mercy of God. The Lord Jesus Christ will keep you if you stand for God and be obedient to His command. So, I just want to say to all of you here, we're in the end. Our image is being formed. The youth of church and state. In 2000, just going to read this and then I'm going to close the prayer. Our time is up. Did President Trump establish a religious office in the White House? It says on May 18th, President Trump established the White House Faith Opportunity Initiative. In the executive office of the President of the United States, the administration said the initiative would give faith-based organizations a voice in the White House. He's keeping his campaign promise. It says, the description of this initiative or religious office did not come from the White House itself. But in a mini, it says, left out the fact that Trump in 2018's initiative was not a radical new departure, but rather represented significant continuity of the earlier initiatives in the presidencies of George W. Bush and Barack Obama, which claim that the president, says here, watch it very carefully. It says here, Occupy Democrats, this is taken from Facebook, posted the mini, and they said here, it goes on and says here, they claim that the president had violated the constitution of separation of church and state by setting up a religious office. President Trump did sign an executive order on May 20th, 2018, to establish a new faith-based office-based initiative within the White House, but nobody from his administration called it a religious office. That description appears to have come from the Occupy Democrats. Furthermore, Trump's initiative represents a significant continuity of, it says, rather than a departure from the previous administrations. Now finally it says, the executive order also says the following, that the initiative will be led by an advisor to the White House Faith and Opportunity Initiative based out of the Office of Public Liaison. of a public liaison. It says executive order abolishes Obama's advisory council for faith-based neighborhood partnerships. Beyond that, Trump's order is somewhat vague on the exact workings of the initiative and the duties of the advisor who will lead it. Now, this one right here was posted on Facebook. You got others. You have one from Washington Post as well. Trump creates a not-so-new faith-based office in the White House. Trump signs order to protect religious freedom and establishes a new White House initiative. Finally, it says here, the order aims to ensure faith-based organizations that have equal access to government funding and equal rights to exercise their deeply held beliefs. We take this step because we know that in solving many problems of our great challenges, faith is more powerful than government, and nothing is more powerful than God. This was in the National Day of Prayer, Donald Trump. Little did he know that prophecy foretells that as time continues, the union of church and state will eventually be not the state controlling the church, but the church controlling the state.
Yeah.
And many of our politicians will be forced to, if they want to get elected, even for the next presidency of the United States, if they want to get elected, they're going to have to bow to the church.
Yeah.
They're going to have to come into conformity with churches. Now, that sounds good for some people, but that is not religious freedom. Mm-hmm. Nor is it fair to the congressmen who are running that they can not hold their dinner. They got to cater to this party in order to get it, because this party got the majority votes. That is not what God and His Word say. We are there. Liberty in this nation on a prayer. And the ultimate end will be with this. While professing to protect religious liberty, the liberty will be given for the majority who will go along with the laws that will be put in place, that the religion will be influencing the state to do. But when anyone begins to dissent from that law, or from that so-called religious law or dogma, whoever that minority may be, they will lose their religious liberty on the fact that they are not in harmony with the common good. This is where we go. And this is when we will speak like a dragon. And the same despotism took place in early history in Europe. And the suppressing of conscience will take place here in this nation if we continue to go down that road for the union of church or religion or church influencing and eventually controlling the state. Sounds good when a time of immorality is prevailing, but it will bring evil results. And it will give rise to the same despot power that had ruled the world for 1260 years. It will give rise to the papacy, but this time it won't be the papacy doing it. It'll be the Protestants who have believed that America needed to be controlled morally by religious laws. God help us. We got to thank God. God help us. Let us pray. Let me ask you a question before I go. How many say, Lord, please help me. Help me to bring my life into conformity with your will. Please. And I want you to keep this congressman in prayer as well. Not only him, but others. Because everybody's not gone. Everybody is not giving over. There's some that know what's right. But they're having a hard time and they have an uphill battle. That was what we're told from the Spirit of Prophecy, that God has placed some men in office to hold in check a multitude of evil that will come if they were not there. That's why I said pray for him. Alright? Now let's pray.
Father in heaven,
Close your eyes and pray.
We bow before thy throne, thanking you for this service. Asking for your Holy Spirit to continually be with each one here. To be more in the hands and decisions that were made. Because you love your people. And you also made an appeal that some will make a decision for Jesus. We pray for Congressman Jeffries that you will please uphold him by your grace. Teach him your word. Teach him how to be wise, how to be tactful. Help him to also be firm and truthful. Above all things, Lord, protect his family and his friends and loved ones. Keep him in his care. Keep him from the corruption that goes on. Lord, help him to know when he must stand, if he must stand alone, that your spirit will be with him. And that you will send help when you need it. Help him to remember in times like these, and help us all remember to fear not, fly in with thee. Be not dismayed, fly in thy God. I will strengthen thee, yea, I will help thee. Yea, I will hold thee to the right hand of my righteousness. Your word has foretold the land like beast in the United States will rise to power. And you've talked about the change that will come. But please help us when that change comes to be faithful, to be loyal, to be true. Please, Lord, help this president. Help his mind. Help him to understand there must be a balance between religion. That religion cannot become the dominant factor in his presidency. Above all, give him men around, give somebody, send some men, send some senators or congressmen who can help him keep that balance. Lest he cross the line. Bring about that which will bring national apostasy and will lead to national ruin. Please help us. Help this nation. We thank you for this religious liberty day. In Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. Turn the service back over to the pastor and to the elders and the youth at this time.
Amen. Was our heart blessed?